folks. Welcome inside the Parisi Palace, high above 2919 East Broadway. This is a special live edition of the Jake Feinberg Show, coming to you live on Power Talk. Please go to our website, powertalk.live, download our free app, and stream all of our live local programming, including Solomon on Blast, the Jim Parisi Show, and yours truly, the Jake Feinberg Show. We can't thank you enough for making us part of your day today. And on my 39th birthday, what an honor to be able to talk to a guy who I have been after for some time. I've been doing quite a bit of woodshedding over the last 6.5 years, talking to unsung accompanists and luminaries about leadership, love, life, and lineage. I get to talk to another cat today, David Clayton-Thomas. Welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Hi, Jake. Happy birthday.
Thank you, man. You made my birthday, man. Thank you so
much.
And
where did you dig up Nobody Calls Me Prophet? You were playing that. I haven't heard that on the radio for years.
Well, all right. We got a game on this program called Name That Tune, Name That Voice. So I want you to listen to this. I want to show you, I want to tell you, this has been this is a huge honor for me, and I want to play this for you, and then I want to come back and we'll break it down, okay?
Okay.
He was quite amazing as a human being. He was a Golden Gloves champion fighter, and a pretty big boy. I mean, I think he was probably a light heavyweight and stuff, and he was abused by his father really badly. And his father used to beat him with a 2x4, and when he was bad. Well, once David got up to be about 16 or 17, all of a sudden he was like 180 pounds, and you know, he'd been studying boxing, and he'd gotten really good at it. And finally, one day, his dad said, "Go down to the basement, David. You've been bad." And David went down there, and his father came down, and David just wasted him. I mean, and his father had him charged with assault, his own father.
All right, Mr. Clayton Thomas, who is that?
Well, I don't know whose voice that is, but it's total crock. It didn't happen. But anyway,
okay, well, no.
I never did beat my dad up. My dad was always tougher than me.
Okay, that was from January 14th, 2013, a dear comrade of yours, Amos Garrett.
Oh, Amos, God, yes, I've known him forever.
Okay, so what I want to get at is this. Whether or not it's a factually true story, I want you to talk about one of the L's on my program is life, and what I mean by life is overcoming adversity. And I really want you to talk to the audience out there, people listening all over the world who are in abusive relationships across the board. Ultimately, how it made you stronger, how you overcame it, and ultimately who it made you as a person today.
Well, yeah, I was an abused kid, although in those days it was even considered child abuse. You know, if your father beat you up, it's because you were a bad kid and the kid went to jail. How things have changed.
I know.
But yeah, I had a very abusive upbringing, and I left home at 14. I just got tired of being a punching bag for the old man, and I just split. I slept in parked cars and abandoned buildings and wherever I go, anywhere but go home. And I guess that's how I started out in life.
Do you look back on that? I mean, what would be your advice for people that are in abusive? I mean, did you become a Golden Gloves boxer, though?
Yeah.
So, well, yeah, I mean, it's legit.
I spent most of my teenage years in jail.
Wow.
And I was on the boxing teams in the joint, so. And that's a very tough place to fight, let me tell you. That's tougher than Golden Gloves.
I would love to. I mean, how did that work? I mean, was it like a the guards would let you just sort of have at it and with any gloves or anything, or you just bare knuckles?
Oh no, they came up with the idea that if they had boxing matches on the Saturday, it would cut out on the violence in the joint, and it did. You know, because I'd rather say if I had a run-in with somebody, which happens all the time in those places, okay, I'll meet you Saturday in the gym. I'd rather do that than go at it with knives in the yard, you know?
Agreed. But do you feel that when you look back on it, did it give you a sense of urgency? I mean, I know you spent a lot of time on the streets, Yonge Street, and what, I mean, you obviously in the Slammer, but did it give you a toughness or a courage to overcome any adversity?
I think so, to a certain degree. I mean, my teenage years were so tough that I came out of it with the feeling like, what could I lose? And I'll do anything to not go back to that. To not go back to the abuse, to not go back to the joint. And I think that drove me forward, gave me a lot of ambition, if you will, because going back was out of the question.
I'm fascinated with this idea. I mean, you were at the heart of. I was out at dinner last night with my daughters and their friends, and I was trying to explain to them who you were. And I'd love you to talk, if you could, about any kind of black Chitlin circuit that was functioning in the Canadian realm. You are a soul singer, and your biggest heroes were black singers. And I would love you to talk about the Chitlin circuit or whatever existed that when you did get out of the joint. And you started to, you know, started a career as a musician. Who you were getting off on, and ultimately, what that vibe was like.
Well, I think that started, and what's called the Toronto sound today is very heavily steeped in R&B. And the reason for that was back in the '60s, there was a Chitlin circuit. If you were a black band from Detroit or Chicago, you played in a black club on the black side of town. And a lot of those artists soon discovered there was no color bar in Canada. And they could come up here and play in any of the clubs. We had an area called the Yonge Street Strip, which was maybe 15, 18 bars right down the main street of Toronto. And you could go down there on a Saturday night and you could see B.B. King playing in one club and the Four Tops in another, and the Muddy Waters band from Chicago. And so we grew up steeped in that music, not because we had a Chitlin circuit up here, but because we didn't. And the black artists could come up here and play anywhere they wanted. And England was very much the same. So a lot of the great R&B artists spent most of the rest of their lives in either England or Canada because there was no color bar here. And not only were they accepted up here, they were idolized. I would sit at the bar nursing a beer for an hour just to watch an hour of the Muddy Waters band, or Albert King or B.B. King or Otis Rush or any of these guys. They all played in Toronto. And there was a club up here called the Blue Note, which was an after-hours club, which meant that it didn't open till 1 o'clock in the morning when all the bars closed. And all the artists used to get together and jam until dawn in this place. And it would be nothing to find yourself, on stage with Martha Reeves singing with any one of a dozen great R&B artists that used to come up there to jam. Because after hours, that's where all the chicks went, and that's where all the people went. And that was a great incubator for the Toronto sound. And that's where the heavy, heavy black influence came from. As I said, not because there was a Chitlin circuit up here, because there wasn't one. And it attracted Detroit, Chicago, Memphis artists would come up here and play all the time. I saw James Brown band. I saw the Ike and Tina Turner band, Ike and Tina Turner Review, for the first time in a club here in Toronto.
I was going to say that, this is again from my interview with Amos. He said there was an intersection between two scenes. Myself, Ian, Tyson were very social with the Hawks. I hung out with David Clayton-Thomas a lot. We drank beer together. David Clayton-Thomas taught me how to play pool. He's a pool shark. He's a pool shark as well. He's an incredible life story. Now, I mean, I guess here's the point. When I interviewed John Mayall earlier this year, he said the same thing about, and I'm not trying to be naive, but at 39 years old, he said the same thing. There was no color bar in England. Why was there no color bar in Canada? And why is it that we still can, why is there still this color bar in the United States?
Well, that's a very deep and complex problem, but was it Abraham Lincoln who said slavery is a scar on our visage that will remain forever?
The original sin.
It was Abraham Lincoln, was it not?
You're absolutely right.
Yeah. And it's true. We, as a country, we never were formed out of a revolutionary war. We basically negotiated our separation from England. We were the end of the Underground Railroad post-Civil War up here, where a lot of the blacks in the South actually fled to Canada. And we do have a huge black population up here, most of them now third and fourth generation Canadians. It's just the way the country evolved and developed. And the roots of American culture go all the way back to slavery. And it's still there today in isolated pockets all over the country. You can still find, people who are very angry that there was a black guy in the White House, okay?
Right.
That attitude didn't exist up here. We've always been a very kind of nice country that just gets along with everybody else. And we're a very multicultural country. Right from the very beginning, we were divided French and English. And then the Scots came in and were a huge Jewish population, World War II. And Italians, and it's extremely multicultural. So it's a not so much a melting pot as a, I think Pierre Trudeau described it as a cultural mosaic, as opposed to a melting pot where everybody comes to this country and must learn English and must be Canadian. We allow cultures to exist within the fabric of our country.
Well, you're nailing this because. We've actually stifled our culture in this country. I've interviewed everybody from Gordon Lightfoot to Ronnie Hawkins. Now I get a chance to talk to you. I've interviewed Paul Schaefer. Now, Lightfoot, but
those guys are all friends of mine.
I know. David, it's you have no idea when you hear some of these clips I have, you're going to be laughing hysterically. But the point is that...
Well, you'll have to send them to me.
I'm going to. It's so cosmic that we even connected. But the point is... Lightfoot even said to me at a certain point, he went to New York, and I'm trying to figure out the chronology here of the first time that David Clayton-Thomas, like how you wound up in New York. And if in fact you wound up, with actually being taken care of by black people.
Well, I don't know. Well, yeah, I guess John Lee Hooker brought me down there.
Yeah.
We had a little area here in Toronto called Yorkville, which was north of where the Strip was. Now, on the Strip, you played R&B, and you mostly played top 40 R&B. And, and everybody dressed in suits, and it was a very R&B scene. But in Yorkville, there was a new culture growing up, and it was artists who wrote their own music. And it was people like Neil Young, Gordy Lightfoot, Joni Mitchell, John Kay, and they were writing their own music. And I started gravitating more and more up towards that scene. There was no money up there, so I couldn't really maintain a band, so I used to play solo a lot. I was always a huge fan of Mississippi Delta Blues. Like Mississippi John Hurt, John Lee Hooker, Sonny Terry, Brownie McGee, Son House. I just loved that music, and I played it on guitar fairly well. So I used to go over between sets at my gig across the street and sit in with John Lee Hooker, and I'd play behind him.
Wow.
Now, I had already been to New York. We had had three number one records in Canada, three hit records. And I was still working in the same club, it didn't make any difference because there was no real music industry here in the 60s.
Right.
As a matter of fact, the entire music industry of the whole world was headquartered in New York City. So I was asked by Paul Anka, another fellow Canadian, to come down. We had a number one record in Canada, and I was asked to come down and play on a TV show he had called Hullabaloo, which was the first NBC... network musical show. And I was Paul and I were the first Canadians to ever be on it. So I went down there and I spent about 3 days there while we were filming for the Hullabaloo show. And in the evenings, I go down and hang out in Greenwich Village. And I saw and got to know people like Richie Havens and Jimi Hendrix and James Taylor and Carole King. And they were all working little clubs down there. And a lot of the artists who worked the clubs in Greenwich Village would come up and play in Yorkville Village, too, in the little clubs up there. So there was tremendous interchange between Toronto and New York. The New York musicians came up here all the time, and we went down there all the time. So a lot of us already knew each other. Well, John Lee Hooker told me one night that he was playing at the Cafe Agogo the following week. And I said, well, take me with you. I'll go. Come on, I'll play backup guitar for you. And he said, okay, but one thing. John Lee Hooker, having grown up in the very deep South, was functionally illiterate and so couldn't get a driver's license. And so he asked me if I would drive him to New York. And I said, okay, so you drive me to New York and I'll give you a gig when you get there. I said, okay. And that was it. I went down and I played the Cafe Agogo behind John Lee Hooker.
Unbelievable. Well, okay, so, again, this is such a high honor to be talking to a luminary character, a guy who made his imprint. You had hit records with the Shays. Which band had hit records already before you?
Both the Shays and the Bossmen. The Bossmen had a record out here called Brainwashed, which was an anti-war song a little too early for what was going on in the States, and never did get released in the States, but it was number one in Canada for like record setting time, something like 20 weeks. It was number one in Canada because Canada was a little bit ahead of the United States in objecting to the Vietnam War. We never did get involved in that. We always thought it was a mess and we never did get involved with it. So an anti-Vietnam War song here was very, very popular. But we never did get it released in the U.S.
There were some jazz cats on there. I'm thinking I've interviewed Peter Appleyard and Bill Crow. Lenny Bro? Who were some of the jazzers on that record?
Well, in Yorkville was played not only the folky kind of Joni Mitchell and Gordy Lightfoot stuff, but there was a lot of jazz artists played there.
Oh, yeah.
And so I got to see Lenny Bro, Oscar Peterson, people like that. And I became really attracted to the world of jazz. I just realized that these musicians were extraordinary. They were playing music on a level that we three-chord rockers weren't even capable of.
Yeah, but you dug it, though. Can you talk about some of the... Because, I mean... What it says somewhere is that this was one of the first groups, the Bossmen, to have jazz players in it. I mean, what were the cats in that band?
Well, I had run across a jazz piano player, a young prodigy named Tony Collicott. Hmm. Tony had played Carnegie Hall with Sarah Vaughan at age 15. He was a child genius. Hmm. And I had run into him in Toronto, and we started discussing the idea of working together. Even though at that point I didn't read or write music, I do now, of course, but he was just on a whole other level musically. So I brought him into a band I had called the Bossmen, which is primarily a guitar band. And Tony just came in and reorchestrated everything. He wrote for the two guitars like they were a horn section. And we co-wrote, actually, the song Brainwashed, which was the number one hit here in Canada. And that was my first experience in working with jazz musicians. Then when I went to New York, of course, I fell in with that same crowd, you know, with the Randy Breckers, who I just worked with in Europe last week, as a matter of fact.
Oh, it's so weird. I just interviewed Randy last week.
Well, Randy and I just spent a week together in Europe. We played the Soulmates Hammersmith.
He said it was an aging rockers tour.
Yeah, I guess it was.
Yeah, no, the 6 degrees of separation is, I don't want to rush into this. Hooker took you down there, and I want to play this next voice for you and see if you can peg it, okay?
Sure.
I met David Clayton-Thomas in Greenwich Village at the Night Owl Cafe. He came in with the band, and he played and sang just like B.B. King from Canada.
Right.
And, I mean, he sounded just like B.B. King. Of course, one of my all-time heroes, and I was like, wow, this guy's really got it. Then he ended up in Blood, Sweat, and Tears. And after that, he became, you know, so he went from, you know, the bottom to the top, kind of. And by the time he was out in L.A., and made that album, you know, we were all hanging out together. I think Chuck was on bass, and that was a big part of it for me. Chuck Rainey was and is one of my absolute heroes in American music. Mm. Just great, great, great.
Wait a minute.
I couldn't believe I was playing.
Is that Spider? Is that Spider Webb?
I've interviewed 700 cats, including Spider. That is Danny Korchmar.
Oh, Daniel. No, I met Daniel in New York.
I bet you met him with
Danny.
Go ahead.
When Danny was playing in a little club called the Four Winds with a band called Flying Machine.
That's right, James Taylor.
The lead singer was James Taylor.
That's right.
And James was unavailable for Saturdays in the afternoon. So I used to go and sub for him on Saturday afternoons. And I got to know Danny and the boys. And, of course, when I went out to L.A. several years later, I ran into Danny again. And what a guitar player. He's a brilliant player.
Well, I got to tell you, man, I found this album, Tequila Sunrise, and it was emblematic. I was like, this character, David Clayton-Thomas, I said, this cat, first of all, everybody in the photo, too, Chuck's holding a little puppy dog. Smitty Smith, rest in peace, is there. Korchmar's there. I mean, that interview was from 2014. So, my question is that ultimately, what Chuck Rainey and Spider Webb, how you love them as a rhythm section. And
When Danny mentioned Chuck Rainey, I immediately thought Spider Webb, because Spider played drums in that band.
He did, but what Danny was saying was that he, even going back to when Chuck was with King Curtis or playing in the studio scenes, he idolized Chuck because he was Danny loves funk music.
That was the rhythm section. When I came to New York, you know, Chuck Rainey, Eric Gale.
Richard T.
Richard, yeah. That was the A-team rhythm section in New York. Yeah, they were the guys. They were the cats.
I'm always fascinated with talking about, ultimately, David, like, if you can go back to your time with, any of the bands in Toronto, but, you know, ultimately where your ears grew the most, because you guys were playing unamplified music for a period of time. You weren't always plugging in. Today, there's very little space in modern pop music. There's no dynamics for the most part. And I'm just trying to get an idea of a bandstand experience where you could point to, where you could say that your ears grew the most.
Well, you can't program emotion into a computer, and most stuff is made by computers today, of course, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They begin with a computerized drum track and then build it up from there. We made music in a much different way. It was much more much more visceral, and just the way the guys in that particular band played and how they communicated musically with each other that formed the sound of the band.
I just was wondering if there was an experience that you could point to on the bandstand with a band where you really felt like you could hear the bottom of the bass. And you could hear the cats. I mean, even the drummers, man. I mean, honestly, Spider Webb was keeping time on the cymbals. He wasn't even using the bass drum to keep time. He was using it as an accent. And I'm just trying to get, you guys were all individualistic. You all had your own sound. And it all came from somewhere. And I'm just trying to get this idea of, like, even if it was when you came to New York, but an opportunity to play acoustically where your ears really grew the most.
Well, Blood, Sweat, and Tears for me was like going to Juilliard because all the musicians in that band were educated musicians. I came down as basically a three-chord R&B rhythm and blues player, And I soon realized in that band, if I wanted to communicate with them, I had to start to learn to speak their language. And I asked Freddie Lipsius, who is now a professor, actually, at Berkeley.
Right.
I asked Freddie Lipsius to start to give me some lessons to teach me how to read and write music. And so he signed me up with a mail order course while we were on the road with Berkeley. And for the next 2 years, I took a mail order theory and composition course under the tutelage of Fred Lipsius. Because to communicate with musicians on that level, you couldn't just kind of say, like, play da-da-dum-dum-dum-dum, you know? You had to say, play the dominant fifth here, and I want a major ninth here. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
You had to speak their language. And so Fred was very, very influential in basically teaching me how to become a musician and not just a three-chord guitar player.
But I guess more specifically, like, I mean, that's when it got... I mean, it's easy to do it sort of in a snail mail fashion, but could you talk about being on the bandstand? If you know, those cats were all wonks, all academics, and they could swing their butts off. So, I mean, was there a time where on the bandstand you could take that learning application and put it into the practical setting? Was there something you could point to, a story?
Oh, every night, not only on the bandstand, but in the studio and as a writer, being able to take my ideas and communicate them to them in their own language. You know, like I say, not just to kind of hum out a tune, but actually to understand what it was that I wanted creatively and communicate that to the guys was incredibly valuable.
Talking to David Clayton-Thomas here on the Jake Feinberg Show. After you sat in for James Taylor and the Flying Machine, how did you wind up connecting? What was your first, how did you get connected with Columbia Records? Was it through Blood, Sweat, and Tears, or how did that all go down?
Well, remember that in those days, this is before the music business moved to L.A. and became a background track for music videos. In those days, the entire music industry of the world was in four blocks of downtown New York called Greenwich Village.
Right.
And all the renaissance of artists that came out of that era was just staggering. And we were all working what were called basket houses. A basket house is where you go in, you stand in line along the wall with three or four other artists with their guitars in their hand, and you get to play two songs and pass the basket. And then you move down to the next club. And so we were all standing in the same lines night after night, me, James Taylor, everybody. Tim Harden, Dave Van Ronk, we all played the basket houses. And so it was a very small area. Like Greenwich Village was like four square blocks in the West Village. And we all knew each other. I saw the new Blood, Sweat, and Tears being formed out of the remnants of what was then called Blues Project. So I knew all these guys anyway. So it ended up to be a very natural place for me to end up, because I already had a half a dozen guys in the band who were friends of mine.
I dig. And
we worked other gigs together too, you know?
No, I mean, I've talked to most of the Merry Pranksters and a lot of them, I mean, there would have really been no psychedelic rock movement in San Francisco without the Beats. Ferlinghetti, Ginsberg, Kerouac,
mm-hmm.
Lenny Bruce. I've done three interviews with Wavy Gravy. I've done two interviews with Bill Cosby. Cosby lived above the Gaslight Theater, Ramblin' Jack Elliott. I've been woodshedding for you. And I would love you to talk about if there were beat poets in the Young Street scene, if so, who they were and if they had impact, or if you were impacted by cats like the bravado of Lenny Bruce, Ferlinghetti, or any of the Merry Pranksters. I mean, these guys, without them, you talked about this renaissance. I think that's a perfect word for it. I would love you to talk about those cats, because those cats emboldened you guys to be yourselves.
Yeah. Although it wasn't on the Young Street Strip. Those artists used to come up and play the Yorkville area. The Yorkville area was the more bohemian strip. okay, down on the Yonge Street Strip, everybody drank beer and played rhythm and blues. The big band, of course, down there was Ronnie Hawkins and the Hawks, who went on later to become the Band.
Of course.
And everybody heard them and figured that they were from the Deep South when they first heard the Band, and they weren't. They were Canadian boys. So a lot of the poets, the beat poets and whatnot, would come and do readings in the little coffee houses on Yorkville. That's where I first became aware of them and started reading stuff like that by Ginsberg and Marshall McLuhan and a lot of other people. And, of course, when I got to New York, Greenwich Village was a hotbed for not only music but poetry and arts and painting and art. It was an art cultural center in general. So you got to know, if you played down there in Greenwich Village, you got to know Andy Warhol, because he hung out there too. And you got to know, you got to meet the Allen Ginsbergs and people like that, because they were all in the same little four-block area.
Can you talk about, I mean, you and Warhol got pretty tight?
No, not really. No, I dated one of his Warhol girls for quite some time. I met... And Andy would come in and see my show from time to time and whatnot. But no, I never got really close with him.
When you finally became so, did you do work as a solo leader prior to Blood, Sweat, and Tears? And when was the first time? Yeah, I mean, did you have Spider and Chuck as your rhythm section? Because I have all of them on the record saying that they all met you back in Greenwich Village. Maybe not Spider, but definitely Chuck. And I'm just curious about who you had as your backing band.
Well, I was with Blood, Sweat, and Tears touring for 3 years after the first big album came out. And then I needed a break. And the band would not stop touring. That's where they made their money. And they were on the road 300 days a year. And I just finally got burned out with it and bought a house out in L.A. And, of course, the first guys I hooked up with out there are the guys that I knew from New York, Danny, Spider, Chuck. You know, I knew these guys already. So we formed a little band out there called the Sanctuary Band and cut an album together. And that's the Tequila Sunrise album.
Yeah, I was going to say, because, like, part of it is also... the idea of spontaneity, and I was hoping that you could talk about the idea of, you know, how ultimately, like, when you come up with ideas, colors, themes, story, how do you sequence your songs in the sense of how do you develop it? It's just really important because we're living through this very vapid time, not unlike, you know, In the late 50s, you know, Little Richard found God, Elvis went to the army, rock and roll took a back seat, jug bands came in the early 60s, but ultimately it's like, what do you have to say for yourself? We listened to Prophet coming in here. I mean, so much of your stuff resembles, you know, hard scrabble. You were living the blues, David. It's hard to sing about the blues when you're living in suburbia. How did you coalesce and create songs?
Well, I never lived in suburbia. I was always a big city boy. And I always, you know, I always got a kick out of Americans when they found out that I was Canadian. They thought I lived in the woods. No, 90% of Canadians live in big cities. Nobody lives in the woods. You know, we live in Montreal, Toronto, Vancouver, you know. So we're very much big city boys. And the transition between New York and Toronto was very, very easy for me. They're very similar. But as far as writing the music is concerned, oh, boy. You know, it's very much a collaboration. It depends on the musicians you're working with at the time and who you're bouncing your ideas and who's feeding you ideas. And that's the way we made music. We didn't start with a computerized drum track and kind of layer everything into it. And the bass player comes in on Tuesday and the guitar player comes in on Wednesday and they never meet each other. I still make my music the same way today. I refuse to go down that path. Although it's technically very efficient and very easy to do it that way, gives you a lot of options, But somehow or another, getting that rhythm section, four guys together in the studio, looking each other in the eye, and playing it live, I can't conceive of making music any other way.
Is it a cost prohibitive today? Are people just lazy? I mean, you continue. Why do you, if there are people listening all over the world right now, what is the incentive to do it that way? Why? I mean, is it just having human beings? Listen, because I mean, I've talked to a lot of cats who were in those LA studio scenes, and they were like in the sessions, they were like a lump on the log. You know, they'd play their part, but they offered nothing. So it is about the quality of the person as well. But, I mean, what would you implore to people about the idea of getting cats in a room and staying away from Pro Tools and just hitting it?
Well, of course, we all use Pro Tools today. That's the way we record.
Right.
But I think the technology has offered us a lot of shortcuts now. Like I said, you can come in and just start with a bass drum. Boom, boom, boom. You know, and once they got that bass drum track down, then the producer is able to layer in whatever colors, whatever options he wants to. And some of them are very, very good at it. You know, Dr. Dre makes incredible records with that kind of method. And I think the whole rap and hip-hop school came out of that method where they just basically start with a drum track and build it up from there. I've just never enjoyed that particular way of making music. I look forward to going into the studio and throwing some ideas out, getting some ideas thrown at me, and seeing what's going to happen when you have four very gifted people kind of firing off each other. That's what making music is all about to me, and still is.
Did
the Canadiana album was done that way.
Yeah, why don't you talk about that?
And it was a huge...
Yeah.
Well, that was a very huge, complex project. It took almost a year to finish. Well, this year is the 150th birthday of Canada. So myself and some of my associates came up with the idea of, let's do something for Canada. And we came up with the idea of doing a song as a celebration of the Canadian songwriter. And we didn't realize what we'd bitten off until we started looking at the catalogs of Canadian songwriters, and it's enormous. You know, from Leonard Cohen going back to Ruth Lowe in the 1940s, a tremendous history of songwriting.
Insane. Roy Buchanan.
Yeah. And so we had an embarrassment of riches here. We had so many songs, we didn't know which ones we could possibly cut. And we had to narrow it down. So we began. But when it came down to recording it in the studio, we actually went in with the rhythm section. And some of the songs developed their groove in the studio. For instance, we did Neil Young's Heart of Gold. Now, I didn't want to do it like Neil. We wanted to take these songs and give each one of them a different look. Either just put our own interpretation to them. So in the studio, I had the drummer Larnell Lewis from... Snarky Puppy.
Wow.
Larnell is one of our most gifted drummers. He's a killer drummer. And we were talking about the song. We got in the studio. We sat around the piano and just talked about Heart of Gold by Neil Young. I picked up my guitar and just started playing like a little reggae. Chick, 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 chick. You know, Larnell started just playing on a pillow with his drumsticks. And I said, uh-oh, that's it. We got it. Let's go. We went back into the inner studio where the instruments were set up. I basically said, Larnell, kick it off. Give me like 8 bars of a reggae kick, drums. And he started. I come in. The band fell in behind me, and that was the record. That kind of magic is why you make music. Not to go in and kind of technically lay this track in and lay that track in. That's the art of the producer, the art of the musician. You cannot record jazz, for instance, that way. You can't go in and lay the drums down and then 2 days later come in and put the piano in. Jazz is all about communication between the musicians. it doesn't work any other way. And I guess I've kind of kept that ethic in my music. But to me, the exciting thing is to go to the studio with an idea to do Neil Young's Heart of Gold and have no idea how it's going to end up.
Well, you never play the same song once, right? I mean, it's that mentality. It's the idea of, can you talk a little bit about if you had any relationship with Bill Graham?
I knew Bill. Yeah. We played both the Fillmores several times, and I knew Bill and had lunch with him in San Francisco a couple of times, and I knew him very well.
What was the genius about that, Cat? Because to me, it's like you could see Blood, Sweat, and Tears, Commander Cody, and the Preservation Hall Jazz Band on the same bill. I mean, when you went out to the Fillmore West, were you playing with Blood, Sweat, and Tears at that point, or were you on your own?
Yeah, with Blood, Sweat, and Tears. The funny thing is, I just played with, as I said, we just did this three-city tour in Europe, and Randy Brecker was with me. And also on the tour was Ian Anderson from Jethro Tull.
Mm-hmm.
And Ian reminded me that I basically got him started in the business. And I said, "How the hell? What are you talking about?" He said, "Don't you remember the first time you played the Fillmore East in New York?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You remember who the opening acts were?" And I said, "No, I didn't get there until right before our show, so I didn't get to see the opening acts." He goes, "Well, the opening acts were the Allman Brothers and Jethro Tull. We were the first opening act. Allman Brothers came on, did their show, and then Blood, Sweat, and Tears." And I said, "My God, I never realized it until this time, and until I got to Europe and started hanging out with Ian." And he reminded me that Blood, Sweat, and Tears basically gave them, Jethro Tull, their first big break in the business. So it all comes around, don't it?
Well, I mean, being that you did play with Lipsius, Colomby, as far as I can gather, wasn't kind of learned on the bandstand to be a drummer. But I really wanted you to talk about, I love talking to cats because when you got into a free form improvisational jam, and obviously you were the lead singer, but when the band lost I just wanted to get David Clayton-Thomas's concept of the idea that any note can be the one.
Well, look, jazz musicians by their very nature are improvisational. They're improvisers. And I think the way we kept our sanity in the early days, especially after we left the clubs and started touring very, very heavily, was that anything could happen at any time on the bandstand. And I've got tapes that people have sent me from years ago where we did some crazy, outrageous things. We just went left turn in the middle of a song because somebody just started, like I started with the chick chick on the Heart of Gold, you know, which mm-hmm. kicked off an idea, and Larnell fell in behind it and blah, blah, blah. And that kind of communication is very, very unique to jazz. And I think I've carried that kind of feeling forward. That's how I make music. And Blood, Sweat, and Tears was, you know, the records tend to get kind of cemented in time. And that became the record. But we never played Spinning Wheel the same way twice, two nights in a row on the road.
Did you get to see Coltrane and Elvin? I mean, did that stuff, not that you necessarily incorporated that in, but when you look at what was going on, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, you also had the improvisation, you had Weather Report, you had Mahavishnu Orchestra, you had Chicago. I mean, there were vocal bands playing rock with jazz chords. You had free form expression bands. I mean, to me, it's like you were marinating in this bastion of improvisation. Go ahead.
The first time we played Madison Square Gardens, our opening acts were Thelonious Monk and Miles Davis.
Get out of here.
You know, and Miles worked with us many times.
Miles worked with Blood, Sweat. Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Oh, yeah. He loved our band.
Oh, my God. This is awesome.
He was a huge fan of our band. You know, as a trumpet player and a jazz musician, he loved Blood, Sweat, and Tears. We played the Newport Jazz Festival together. We played Madison Square Garden together. We played, I believe, I believe he was on our Hollywood Bowl concert also.
Yeah, because I remember talking to Peter Yarrow, and he said that they asked if Hollywood Bowl asked him for an opening act, and he said, well, you know, we don't need one. We don't want one. And they said, well, you need to have one. He goes, well, if we're going to have one, we're going to choose Thelonious Monk. And the audience clearly waiting for a more folks, you know, accepting a more folksy acoustic set. Actually, Peter had to go out and actually explain to the audience who this man was, Thelonious Monk. Can you talk about, not going back to the color bar thing per se, but just the idea of what made these cats so inspirational to someone like yourself? I mean, everyone talks about Miles turning his back on the audience, or Coltrane coming up to Miles and saying, what do you want me to play? Miles turns his back on him. And there's all this nonverbal communication on the bandstand. But, I mean, can you just riff on that? Like, what made those cats so inspiring to you?
They're jazz musicians. That's what they do. And I work almost exclusively with jazz musicians. And we may bend the genre a little bit, and because of my voice and whatnot, and the way I write, the material may be a little more rock-oriented, but I've always worked with jazz musicians. They're the best. And they improvise, and they have incredible technical skill, incredible technique. That's just what the kind of musician I've always gravitated to. And even here in Toronto, all my best friends are the jazz community.
I mean, specifically like Thelonious Monk. That guy wasn't accepted as a genius until after he died.
Well, very few people are.
No, but I mean, like, he was totally missed. I get you, you know, but jazz musician. Listen, I mean, here's the deal, Mr. Thomas, is that, listen, jazz, the word jazz is so, has been so perverted now that nobody really knows what that word even means. So it's people that can truly improvise. Now, that means, you know, but improvisation is a very loose term. You know, you could improvise within a rock tune. You know, you could improvise within a
song. Oh, sure.
You know, so it's like, you know, to me, it's like, you know, these guys were just, you know, but they were never, were they recognized by the audiences at places like Madison Square when you opened up for them? Because, you know,
Of course, they were there to see Blood, Sweat, and Tears, so they were jazz fans to begin with. Remember, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, in its earliest inception, was a jazz band. It wasn't considered to be a rock band. Only after we got popular did suddenly the jazz community turned its back on us and said, oh, they're a rock band. You know, the worst thing I guess a jazz musician can do is have hit records.
Well, I remember,
it's happened to a lot of artists, you know, Cannonball Adderley, George Benson, superb jazz musicians who went on to have pop hit records and kind of lost their jazz credibility, although Cannonball never did. But you know what I mean?
I think
we pigeonhole people too much by labels, and they're mostly thought up by marketing people at the record companies. You know, what's selling this month? Oh, hip hop. Okay, we'll call this hip hop, and next month it's rap. And you know what I mean? They're marketing labels. They have nothing. They're not in a musician's vocabulary. We don't think that way. Music is music.
I also often wonder, and maybe you can shed some light on this. I've talked to the conga player Big Black, who used to play at the African Room with Randy Weston, and jazz used to be jazz, JASS. I mean, were you
way back in the New Orleans days? Yeah,
you're right. I mean, I gotta believe that there were brothels in Toronto where you wanted to get a piece of ass, you'd be going down to listen to some jazz. Had the Z's been added? Because the Z's were added by white journalists, hopefully, like, not like myself, but I regret that if I was around. I mean, once they realized that that Dolphy and Miles and Train and these guys, Mengus, once they realized that they could be marketed, they dropped the S's, right? I mean, were you around for the jazz period?
No, it was way before my time. That's back in the Kid Ory days. You know, it's funny when you walk through the airport in New Orleans,
yeah,
and you see all the turn-of-the-century jazz bands. They were all mixed bands. There were tons of white guys in those bands. it wasn't necessarily a black art. The foundations of jazz.
Right, but the foundations of the business were controlled by the mafia too. I mean, the mob.
Well,
the mob had a lot of clubs open too.
Well, I guess they did, yeah. But you know, we never got to meet those guys.
I got one more voice.
Our job, our experience was the dressing room and the stage.
Well, I mean, we're talking to a luminary figure here, a guy who just is continuing to create and doing it in the most holistic fashion, David Clayton-Thomas. One more voice for you here, and then we'll come back.
Okay.
David and I were friends long before that record.
How did you guys meet originally?
We met in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a background singer. And an excellent singer. To this day, David and I are friends. And that rhythm section right there, I worked many times with Testy Calderon, with Spider, and with Smitty. We did a lot of sessions together in L.A. Now, David lived in Mandeville Canyon in L.A. for that album. He recorded that album. Well, we rehearsed that album many days at his house. And it was always great to go out there because we had to ride through Beverly Hills in order to get there. And he had a nice house. We had a wonderful time. And we spent probably Monday, Wednesday, and Friday for about 2 weeks rehearsing those songs or just being together. As a matter of fact, Tessie and Spider went out on the road with him. I couldn't go because I was too busy.
That's Spider.
That is Chuck. That's Chuck Rainey.
Oh, that is Chuck.
That's Chuck. I've done two interviews with Chuck, and, you know, exhausting interviews. But you were doing background singing, too?
Yeah, forgive me for not recognizing all these voices, but you're dragging them up from my youth.
Hey, let me tell you something. I have been asking. I have been after you for 4 years, and then suddenly on Facebook, your social media person friended me, and I said, hey, can I catch a hang with David? She's like, well, you know, she passed me over to Eric, but you have to realize, man, this interview with Rainey, that went back to 2013. And I think what you said before about, I forget exactly what you were talking about, how it all kind of comes around. But I mean, my show has been dedicated to love and the lineage of music. And to talk to you, man, is like, I mean, I've been woodshedding on this for a long time. But I mean, you were doing backup vocals for a while in the studio as well.
I was doing anything that would allow me to pay the rent, you know. Yeah, I sang on other people's sessions. I do it today. I just did a duet last week with a young 15-year-old singer and her little college band, just because it's fun to do and it's great to encourage and mentor young talent coming along, you know. I didn't do it for any amount of money or anything. I just did it because I heard this young lady sing. I thought she had extraordinary grasp of music for 15 years of age. And she asked me if I'd do a duet with her. I said, sure. Went in the studio and did it. So, no, I was never that much of a background singer. Oh, just a minute. My other phone's ringing.
No
problem. Hold on.
Yeah.
Just a second. Coming from Germany. Hold on just a minute.
No problem.
Hello? Yes? Leslie, I'm on an interview right now with Texas, with Arizona. Can you call me back in 15 minutes? Okay? Thank you.
It was a call from my friend Mandoki in Germany. We just got finished a series of concerts with him.
What is the, could you talk a little bit about the health of the live touring circuit and how much of a challenge it is for younger cats? I mean, granted, David Clayton Thomas is a household name. Blood, Sweat, and Tears is a household name. Journey, Steve Miller Band, all these people are living off their reputations because of the touring circuit that existed at one time. I interviewed Floyd Sneed from Three Dog Night, and that dude was playing with country singer. I mean, what is the state of the live touring circuit in the world today?
Well, I don't tour much anymore. I will only do something special, like I just went over to Europe and did three wonderful concerts with Randy Brecker and Ian Anderson and Bobby Kimball and Leslie Mandoki, etc. That's an event. That's something to do. As far as going on the road is concerned, I don't do that anymore.
I guess.
Yeah, but by going on the road, I mean, going out on 100-day tours and stuff like that. I don't do that anymore.
Right.
I'd much rather spend my time in the studio.
You know, I was going to say that, but in general, I was going to ask you, you know, going back to Miles, he said that, I remember talking to Dave Holland, and when he joined the band, Coltrane would go up to Miles and say, "What do you want me to play? What do you want me to play?" And Miles kept turning his back on him. And after a while, Coltrane realized that, in fact, Miles just wanted him to be himself and play that's why he hired him. And we're a very verbose.
I just, the Mandoki tour I just did, Bill Evans was playing saxophone. And Bill, of course, worked with Miles for years.
Yeah, heavy cat, you know. But I mean, and Bill Evans, the sax player, not Bill Evans, the piano player. But,
right.
But what I wanted to ask you is, we live in a very, everybody hangs on words now. We're talking on the phone. You were a singer primarily. But on the bandstand, can you talk about some qualities of nonverbal leadership that you've displayed on the bandstand over your career?
Well, you know, the singer is just another instrument in the band, isn't he? You know, so he takes it where he wants to go, and everybody else throws in their two cents worth. It's a very liquid kind of situation, especially when you're performing live. You know, you can either have a mandated show where everything is note for note written out and perfect, or if you work with jazz musicians, almost anything can happen.
Can you talk to the audience about your concept of love and how you bring love to this world?
Well, my love is making music. Simple as that. And at this point in my life, I'm really involved in making new music as part of my legacy. And that's why I'm not touring anymore. Like I say, I'll do an occasional concert, but if it's a special event and something I really want to do. But I would much sooner be writing and be in the studio and producing new music.
Absolutely. Before I let you go, if you could you tell me a good Richard Manuel story?
Well, I knew those guys. I knew all those guys. Levon and I were very close.
Talk about Levon, because you know what? Like Jim Keltner told me about Levon, seeing Levon drumming. Jim Keltner was a jazz snob, and he saw Levon drumming, and it changed his whole world. But beyond that, can you talk about Levon?
Well,
yeah.
On the Canadiana album, we did Ophelia.
Really?
Which for me was the... You haven't heard that album yet, obviously.
I need to get a copy of it.
Yeah, it's pretty extraordinary. It's we're very proud of it. But we did Ophelia by the band because I wanted to include a band song. And that, to me, was like Levon's signature song. And we actually recruited a drummer for the session that played like Levon. He was a Levon Helm devotee, you know, and so we wanted to get that Levon groove on the song, and we basically hired a drummer who played exactly like Levon, was a Levon Helm fan. But I knew Levon very, very well throughout his whole life. When I lived in New York, I lived in Nyack, and he lived up in Catskill, up just north of me, so we saw each other quite a bit. And he was just a terrific guy. I miss him terribly.
Can you talk just as best you can about the kind of time feel? Like, what was his sound? How could you describe his sound rhythmically? My show has actually become a lot about rhythm. Spider Webb had his own rhythms. Bobby Colomby had his own rhythms. How would you describe Levon's rhythm?
Oh, Levon was a funk drummer, you know. Levon had the best pocket. Is a musician term, the best groove, and a very versatile, very intelligent musician. He played a half a dozen different instruments. I mean, I've heard him pick up the guitar and blow Robbie away, you know?
Right. Well, he was originally a guitar player. That's right.
Yeah. And he was an incredibly musical guy. And to be able to play the way he played and sing at the same time, was pretty remarkable, because he was just a total package.
Well, David, if you don't mind, I'm going to reach out to you later. I'd like to get your email so I can send you all these interviews with people. I think you're going to really enjoy it a lot.
Yeah, very easy. It's David Clayton-Thomas,
yeah.
All one word, @me.com. Very easy.
David Clayton-Thomas.
@me.com.
Thank you for making my birthday morning, man. I have been trying. I've been working Amos. I've been working Ronnie Hawkins. Nobody would give me any contact information on you until serendipity struck and I connected with your social media person. And quite honestly, a lot of the stories you say today are going to be going up and blowing all over the world today. So I look forward. I would love to do part two with you down the road, man. I had a ball with you.
All right. Great talking with you, Jake.
All right, man. Be good.
You have a good day.
Later on.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, another one of the books here. Jake Feinberg just taking care of an interview with the legendary David Clayton-Thomas. And we will be back momentarily with a legendary singer, Andy Kim.